that Julia subject today sounds very, very interesting because she is going to address about the quantum approach to energy storage. Since energy storage is really the fashion these days for many reasons, I think that it can be a very, very peculiar, interesting presentation that she is going to offer us on her PhD work. So Julia, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you for the presentation and for the organization of these events. And so I can share my screen.
All looks fine.
Okay.
Yeah, perfect.
Okay, so today I'm going to speak about quantum batteries and in particular about their realization on an IBM quantum platforms. So more in detail, I will give you a brief introduction to quantum batteries. Then I will present the IBM devices. I will introduce some figures of merit that will be necessary to understand the performances of quantum batteries. Then I will speak about the qubit quantum batteries, so quantum batteries built by a two-level system. I will speak about the pulse that we will use to charge the batteries. I will speak about the calibration phase, so how we can interpret data that we extract from IBM devices. And then I will show you some plots in order to characterize the charging of these batteries. In the second part of the presentation, I will speak about the qubit quantum batteries. So the same idea, but the battery will be made by a three-level system. In this case, we have a larger possibilities in order to choose the charging protocols. And then I will again speak about the calibration phase and the characterization of the charging. So let's start by the introduction to quantum batteries. Quantum batteries are devices able to store energy and then supply it in a fast and controlled way to other quantum systems. So the idea is to couple quantum batteries to another quantum devices like sensors or quantum computers. Research in this field started about 10 years ago, and today, it's both from a theoretical and an experimental point of view. From an experimental point of view, we have just a few experiments, and they are at the very beginning, but they will be more in the future. So, I'm sorry. This is the sketch of what I mean with a quantum battery. We have an empty battery, and we usually address the ground state as the empty state. And then we have a charger. The charger can be a classical system or a quantum system like the battery. And the objective, the goal, is to promote the battery from the ground state to the excited state, and so to store energy inside the battery. In this presentation, I will speak only about the charging phase. Then, of course, we should address the storing of the energy inside the battery and then the discharge in order to produce work and useful work. So the motivation behind researching quantum batteries are mainly two. On the one hand, the miniaturization of the electronic devices lead to the study of thermodynamics in the quantum regime. And so in the field of quantum thermodynamics, we can find also the problem of storing energy, and so quantum batteries. On the other hand, some theoretical studies show that non-classical features like superposition, entanglement, and many-body collective behaviors can lead to better perform with respect to classical batteries. In particular, we can have a better stored energy, better charging time, and average power that we can produce with these batteries. The first experiment that started to demonstrate these properties was made with a system of fluorescent motor. So it's a super extensive scaling of the maximum power that we can store inside this system with respect to the number of molecules that we store in the cavity. In this experiment, the batteries was the molecules and the light trapped inside the cavity was the charger that make energy stored inside the batteries. Another experiment that I want to address is this one made on a platform very similar to IBM platform, so very similar to platforms that I have used. This is a Q-Trit, so a three-level system, and it is made by a Transmon. And in this case, they show the energy that they can store inside these devices. Notice that the time scaling, it's about 100, 200 nanoseconds. And this is a good result, but with IBM quantum batteries, we can do better. So now let me introduce IBM devices. As I said before, they are a superconducting qubit and they work in the Transmon regime. Transmons are sort of practically an anharmonic oscillator. They are similar to an harmonic oscillator, but the inductance is substituted with the Josephson-Johnson. And this let us to have the anharmonicity. The anharmonicity let us work on a subspace, and usually we will work with just the first two states, so the ground state and the first excited state, and then we will see that we can go up. Here you can see the Hamiltonian of this system. The first term is the battery part of the Hamiltonian, and the second term it's the interacting Hamiltonian that will let us to charge the system. Notice that we have just a Pauli matrix that represents the batteries, and the charger is a classical drive. These are some parameters that we have in IBM devices, and because of the coupling between the charger and the battery, it's very small with respect to the level spacing of the quantum battery. We have to choose a drive in resonance with the level spacing of the battery. So it's crucial to put delta inside the cosine of the driver. These two conditions let us to work in rotating wave approximation, and so we can solve analytically this Hamiltonian. In order to perform the rotating wave approximation, we have to do a time-dependent rotation with the delta. We can move to the rotating frame, and by a simple calculation, we can get the rotating Hamiltonian. At this level, we can perform the approximation, and so we can neglect the fast oscillating terms, so the exponential terms in the matrix. And we get a very simple Hamiltonian. In the time evolution, the constant term is not crucial, and so we have just a term proportional to sigma x. At this point, we can introduce the figures of merit. There are several figures of merit that are used in order to characterize the performances of quantum batteries. But in this work, I in particular consider the average energy. The average energy is defined in this way, where this is the Hamiltonian of the battery. So we have just this term, and we don't have the term that coupling the battery with the charger. And what we have is that the energy stored in the battery is proportional to the probability to find the battery in the excited state, so in the state one. I'm sorry. We can consider the qubit in a generical starting state, and we can evaluate this energy as a function of time. What we find out is that the energy depends on time, mediated by this parameter theta, that is nothing else than the area under the envelope of the drive that we use in order to charge the battery. I have reported here the drive that we use. The cosine is the oscillating part, and then we have an envelope that modulates these oscillations. So the key parameter is the area under the envelope. From a theoretical point of view, the exact form of the envelope doesn't matter. And so in theory, we can choose whatever we want. The main goal of quantum batteries is to start from the ground state and to go to the excited state in order to store the maximum energy inside the battery. So if we choose the ground state as the initial state, we get a very simple form of the energy, and we can see that in order to have the energy equal to delta at a time tm, we have to choose a pulse with theta equal to pi. So this will be the condition that we have to respect. Introducing all these base elements, we can move to the qubit quantum batteries. So in order to have an explicit expression of the energy, we of course have to choose a specific form of the drive, and also in order to make this on the IBM machine, we have to choose a specific form of F. And we have used the Gaussian drive. So this is the generic form of the drive. And we have evaluated theta with the approximation that Tm goes to infinity. This approximation is respected if Tm is very greater respect to sigma. With the Gaussian, it's not necessary that Tm is very, very greater to sigma. And these values are really, really good. So this is the form of the drives with some choices of standard deviation of the Gaussian. And this is the energy as a function of time divided by delta. What we can notice is that 95% of the charging of the batteries, that it's already really good, achieve in about the 60% of time. This is because at the beginning and at the end of the charging, the energy is quite constant. So now I will show the calibration phase, and then I will speak about the constraints that the classical drive must respect. These constraints are due to the experimental parameter of the machine that we have used. Then I will speak about the maximum storable energies in these devices and the minimum time that we need in order to perform the charge. So this is an example of the data that we can extract from IBM machines. Blue dots are obtained performing a measure just after the initialization of the qubit. So they represent the ground state. The red dots are measured after the application of a pulse with theta equal to pi. So they are in the excited state. With these two distribution, we can divide the space in two regions. In the case of the qubit, the division say it's quite easy, and we have used the axis of the segment joining the center distribution. And after the division, we can quantitative define the energy store in a generic state of the battery, just counting the number of dots in the one part of the plane with respect to the all dots. Notice that each dot is an experiment, so we have to repeat the measure many, many times in order to have a proper statistic. Because we can't measure the qubit before the end of the pulse, we can't really perform a time-dependent study of the energy stored inside the battery. What we can do is to act on the battery with different pulses, with different theta associated to each pulse, and to study the evolution of the energy as a function of this parameter theta. Then we can reconstruct the time-dependent evolution of the energy a posteriori by calculation. So we can choose two approaches. The first one is what you can see on the slide. So we keep a constant amplitude of the drive, and we change the standard deviation in order to have the right theta. In this case, we try different values of the amplitude. And what we can see is that when we choose a very high amplitude equal to one, it's the maximum amplitude that we can choose with IBM devices, we notice that the energy stored in the battery is smaller with respect to the other cases. And what we noticed is that with this amplitude, we have a very, very thin Gaussian drive. And so the non-zero part, it's very, very short in time. And it's so short to be compared to the discretization of the signal inside the devices. So we don't have a really control on how much of area we are giving to the pulse. And seeing the data, we think that we are giving an area smaller than pi with this type of amplitude. So what we conclude is that it's important to maintain the pulse large enough and to avoid too high amplitude. Another approach, and probably more safe, is to keep fixed the standard deviation of the pulses and change the amplitude. In this case, we can control very well the how large is the pulse. And so we can check that it is large enough with respect to the discretization of the signal. And then we can evaluate the amplitude in order to have the proper theta. What we notice in this case is that we don't have an obvious dependence of the charging process with respect to the standard deviation that we choose. Of course, if we choose a standard deviation that let us to use the approximation of Tm goes to infinity when we evaluate the area. But an interesting thing that we noticed is that the maximum energy is not achieved for theta equal to pi, but for a smaller theta. In order to better understand what is happened, we perform a fit with a generic initial state. So we don't assume that the battery is in the ground state at the beginning of the process, and we evaluate the parameter A and the parameter phi from the data. So in these plots, the colored line are the experimental data with their errors, and the black ones are the best fit. What we can see is that the value of A is around 97%. So we have a 3% of energy already stored in the battery at the beginning of the process. And we have also a positive phase between the ground state and the excited state. We don't have a really control over this phase, but the presence of this phase justifies the anticipation of the maximum. So the reason why we achieve the maximum stored energy before the theta equal to pi, it's inside these values. At this point, we studied what is the minimum time that we have to perform the charge. And with the Armonk device that we used to study the qubit battery, we have a time of 100 nanoseconds. And this time it's similar to the time that I show you at the beginning with the Kutrit quantum batteries experiments. Later, we move to a more general batteries, and we use a Kutrit. Transmons are not genuine to level systems, and with the IBM machine, we can achieve the more excited state. Of course, these devices are not optimized to achieve the second excited state, but nothing avoid this. So we started to realize the Kutrit quantum batteries. This extension allows, on the one hand, to store a greater amount of energy in the same device. So we don't have to change the parameters of the device in order to store a greater amount of energy. And the other hand, we have a richer variety of charging protocols, and so we can perform a more richer study in order to optimize the stored energy and the minimum charging time. I just recall the previous experiment just to say that this is possible and that someone else already did this. The Hamiltonian of the system in the Kutrit case, it's a bit more complicated. We have the free state of the battery, and then we have the coupling between the ground state and the first excited state, and between the first excited state and the second excited state. We can choose two different forms of the drive, and in particular, two different frequencies, and in principle, two different forms of the envelope. Also in this case, we can perform the rotating approximation. So we go to the rotating frame and we evaluate the rotating wave Hamiltonian. And we can see that this term is equal to the term that we have in the qubit case. And then we have the second term that couple the first excited state and the second excited state. Also in this case, we have to work in resonance with the level spacing. And so we have to choose the frequency of the first drive equal to the level spacing between the ground state and the first excited state, and the frequency of the second drive equal to the level spacing between the first excited state and the second excited state. I said that we can perform different protocols. The first one that one can think, it's a sequential protocol, so a two-step protocol, where we perform a first drive in order to promote the battery from the ground state to the first excited state, and then a second drive in order to perform to promote the battery from the first excited state to the second excited state. And then we can measure the system. In this limit, each step is equal to the qubit charging, so we can solve the system in two steps. Another protocol that we can think and we can perform, it's a one-step protocol in which we can promote the battery from the ground state to the second excited state without stop on the first excited state. In this case, we have a sort of virtual passage from the first excited state. And in order to do this, we have to perform the two drives at the same time with their frequency. So the first pulse it's modulated with the frequency equal to the level spacing between the ground state and the first excited state, and the second one with the first excited state and the second one. Also in this case, the problem is analytically solvable, but it's qualitatively different from the previous one. We can so analytically evaluate the energy stored in the battery as a function of time. And we can see that in the blue line, we have the two steps protocol. And in the red line, we have the one-step protocol. Notice that we are using the same form of the drive that we used in the qubit case, and we choose sigma equal to Tm under 8 because it seems to be the best choice of sigma. In this case, the calibration phase, it's a bit more complicated because the first excited state dots and the second excited state dots are really close. So first of all, the blue dots are obtained like in the qubit case, measuring the system just after the initialization. The red dots are obtained after the application of a p-pulse, and the red dots are obtained after the application of the sequential protocol. So in order to divide the space in three regions, we use a machine learning library, we use Scikit-learn, and we use a support vector machines method. We use the linear kernel because line seems to be the best choice in order to divide these type of distributions. After the calibration, we can associate an energy to each state of the Q-treat, and so we can plot the energy as a function of theta. In this case, the definitions of theta, it's a bit more delicate with respect to the qubit case, because we have two pulses, but it's always possible to define it. And so we have in the picture the blue line that is the experimental points, and the black line, it's the analytical curve of the energy as a function of theta. And in this case, the red line, it's the experimental point of the one-step protocol, and the black line again is the analytical line. Notice that we have used two different devices, and that the time need for the charging is very small with respect to the time that we saw before. They are 30 nanoseconds in the one-step protocol, and two pulses of 15 nanoseconds in the two-steps protocol. So also in the two-steps protocol, we have 30 nanoseconds of total charging time. And we achieve an energy higher than 90%, that it's still very good. So to conclude, with the Gaussian drive, we can achieve almost the complete charging, 90% in the case of the Q-treat and 95% in the case of the qubit. I just wanted to underline that it's not strange that we achieve a smaller amount of energy in the Q-treat case, because IBM devices are not optimized to achieve the second excited state. And we can do this in a very short time, between 20 or 100 nanoseconds. The minimum time depends of the value of G, that is the coupling between the battery and the classical drive. And this value is different for different machines. But they are very, very short with respect to the typical decay time of these devices, that are 100 microseconds. Then we can see that the performances of this device, seen as quantum batteries, can take advantage from the errors associated to the operations. And with this, I'm thinking to the anticipation of the maximum that we have because of the positive phase. And at the end, we can say that IBM devices that are optimized in order to work in a completely different fields, such as the quantum computing fields, can already efficiently work as two and even three level quantum batteries. And so with this, I have concluded my presentation, and I thank you for your attention.
Excellent. Many thanks, Julia. I didn't see anybody posing questions to the chat or raising the hand, but we have already one. Bogdan, do you want to pose your question directly?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you for your presentation. I guess you know that the IBM devices are calibrated at least once per day, or even several times every day.
Yeah.
And when you do your experiment, for instance, you read the resonance frequency from the calibration of the device, but which may date from yesterday, let's say, or even a few days before, if it's a weekend. Is there any systematic influence of your results, the fact that the resonance frequency can shift between two calibrations, and you don't know the real value?
No, we tried to perform the charging in different days, in different hours of days in order to test this thing, but we didn't notice a really difference in the charging performance. And I didn't say this, but we perform the calibration each time that we do a charging.
Okay. So you do your own calibration.
I said the calibration in order to divide the space in two or three regions and to evaluate the energy.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bogdan. Anybody else? Also comments or feedback for Julia? No, I don't see more. So one, going two, going three. Okay, so I think that we stop it here. Just to remind you that we have been recording this presentation, so you can watch it again or pass it to your colleagues who might be interested. And the recording will be likely be available next week on Monday. Other than that, thank you very much, Julia. We cannot offer you some clapping in a room, but thank consider you. Yourself very much appreciated in the work that you are doing and in the presentation that you have offered us. And with this, I wait for you for next event, which is being scheduled in June. So keep an eye. I will be posting the news as usual, and you will see when the announcement is coming about 1 week before. So you will have the time to prepare. Say thank you, Julia, again. And thank you, everybody, for joining us.
Thank you for the organization.
That's not a pleasure.